My name is Lars Scholten. I am a lead instructor from Maxen in the Netherlands. And today I want to do a presentation here at the IBC. And I've been doing this already for quite a few years, doing presentations. And most of the time I now dive into a project that I have created in the last year. The only problem this time, when Maxen contacted me to do another presentation, is the fact that all the projects I'm currently doing are still under wraps. I signed those beautiful NDAs not to talk about stuff, and here I am talking about stuff. So today I decided to, well, do something different. As you can see, I got a ridiculous setup here, and that's because I'm going to talk about plugins, Cinema 4D plugins, which can be very useful inside your workflow. So Cinema 4D is already a powerhouse. You can do immensely amazing stuff with the program. But for those little specific tasks, it's always nice to have plugins, libraries, and scripts to help you out. So last year, I did a presentation for the people of Maxen about those plugins. And it's actually kind of interesting how many of them are not really well known. So I decided to shift the focus from the most popular plugins, like, for instance, XParticles or the guys from Grayscale Gorilla, because they already have a lot of exposure because the plugins are pretty damn good, and now show you a few of the lesser-known plugins. And I would like to start off with the fact that I'm currently using Release 20 and Release 19. So be aware that many of the plugins which are now working in 19 have to be recompiled to work in 20. Many of them already did a recompile, but some of them still have to be translated to a language that Release 20 understands. So first things first, one of the most favorite plugins I have been using on a daily basis is something called Drop to Floor, which was in the past created by a guy called Kuroyome. I believe he's Japanese. And if you now go to his website, you will find, well, the empty space of Picasso. There's nothing there. The domain hasn't been maintained for quite a long time. So when we were thinking about an update of this very important plugin, we could not count on him anymore, I'm afraid. So by popular request, a guy called Adam from AlphaPixel decided to rewrite this plugin for Release 20 of Cinema 4D. And what it does is actually what you think that it does. It takes an object, you go to the plugin, and you just say drop to floor, and the object is set on the floor. Which sounds ridiculously easy, but I had some contact with Adam, and he said, it's pretty damn difficult to accomplish this, because as you can see, this Wacom pen that I have modeled here is a null object with a group, and it's also standing tilted. So to define which is the bottom point of this Wacom pen is kind of a big feat. So Kuroyoma in the past also had another plugin which is called Drop It, so you can actually stack objects on top of each other. He was thinking about also doing that plugin, but I won't force him. But yeah, it's a free plugin, but I should say, if you have the chance, go to AlphaPixel and donate a little bit of money, because it's one of those plugins which is incredibly important. I use it just about 20,000 times a day in my working process. So another one of those have to have is this guy. It's called Perfect Split. And especially when you are going to work with 3D models which are created from scan, or maybe from a different piece of software, which is now in Release 20, also far more possible because of the new CAD import options. You might end up with a problem file like this guy. And you can see here, it's one mesh. It's only one object. Now, let's say in the past, I needed to get this wheel off the car. Then I needed to do quite a few things. It's a very dense mesh. So what I will do instead here, I'll just start it off. And let's use Perfect Split. In the meanwhile, because it's currently running, what you had to do in the old days is first make a polygon selection. Duh. Then you had to go to your menu and use the split command. Then you had to delete the polygons from the original model. And then you had to define the perfect axis of the model you have just created, which you had just extracted from the original model. And while I was talking about this, this plugin already did this. So what you can see here is that I have a wheel which is now separated from the rest of the body, and the pivot point is dead center. I like that. So another free plugin, which is absolutely worth downloading. Now, let's go to far more interesting stuff, Infinite Ocean. And Infinite Ocean is not so much a plugin as it is a library. So no release 20 problems here at all. And what this is, it's literally what you think it is. It's a infinite ocean or an infinite landscape. Like they also have infinite canyons, infinite mountains, infinite desert, infinite space. And what you can do here is pretty funny. Just double click. And right here, now I have an ocean. And the thing is, when it comes to creating water simulations inside Cinema 4D and any other program, to be honest, is that if your ocean is, well, going out and being very long and you want to have, let's say, a plane fly over the ocean and it goes on and on and on, at a certain point, you will reach a certain edge. For instance, you have this plugin called Hot4D, which is a brilliant free plugin to create some water, but you need some kind of cay, some kind of end, an island or whatever. With Infinite Ocean, the ocean is actually being created inside the viewport of the camera. So, right now, if I grab my camera, and let's say I rotate it around, you can see that the sea is being generated inside the view of the camera and nothing outside. So if I move the camera forward and backward, the mesh is actually being created again inside the view. So right now, I have this ocean over here. And just to show you how it will look with a little bit of physical sky, it looks pretty damn good. You can adjust foam, you can adjust the height, you can adjust the choppiness, and also the scale of this ocean. So Infinite Ocean is not only very suitable for the creation of a ocean, it's also very suitable to create, for instance, the canals of Amsterdam. We actually are doing that right now in a project, that's the reason I wanted to show you that. Now, this is all pretty cool and nice and dandy, but the best thing about this Infinite Ocean is a request that I actually had pretty lately. What I have here is something completely new in version 1.6, virtual reality. We all love virtual reality. You can make 360 movies inside Cinema 4D with a spherical cam. And now they also made it so that you have the opportunity just to go to your camera, maybe even do some stereoscopic stuff, watch through the camera, and if I press render, you will see that I get a complete 360 ocean inside Cinema 4D, which we can travel for ages and ages and ages. You can travel thousands of miles and will always work. So Infinite Ocean is pretty cool. And again, the guys from C4 Depot, that's their website, also have infinite canyons, infinite mountains, and everything just about infinite. And it's just pretty damn awesome. For the people who are using different render engines, like for instance Octane, those shaders that are being used, of course, do not work too well in other render engines, but you can use your own shaders on top of the mesh which is being created. So also for them, it can be a very nice solution. Now, let's go to the next one. And the next one is actually not so much a real plugin, it's a set of scripts. And these are developed by a guy called Holger Bierbrach. And as far as I know, this guy is also, yes, that's the one I wanted to show. This guy also worked for iXponsor, for instance, and he is a modeling enthusiast. And what I really like about this modeling kit is it gives you a lot of new tools who can solve problems which you can have while modeling your objects. And one of the things that I, for instance, really like is it has an updated version of the solo option. So let's say I want to work on these rings. I can just press S, bam, and I'm here with a close-up of the model I want to adjust. If you have a polygon selection, it will zoom in on the polygon selection. If you have an object group, it will zoom in on the object group. And behind the scene, it will actually create a new camera which is zoomed in on the object that you want to change. Want to go back? And you're back, and you can just work on the rest of the scene. So this is already pretty handy, and I must say, if this script bundle is not installed on my system, I am really lost. I always need this solo button. It's already worth to get this model kit. So another few things you can actually do with this model bundle is the following. A few scenarios which can be pretty annoying if you are working in Cinema 4D. Let's say, for instance, this guy. I got a object right here. And what you can see right now is that we have these points selected. And I want them all to line up. And inside Cinema 4D, to be able to do this can take a bit of time. So what I do here is I make a point selection. Then with Shift, I also make a edge selection and just press this button. Et voila, everything's straightened out. As a modeler, I use this a lot. And of course, I expect a little question or a remark from the public. Hey, Lars, this is pretty nice. Hey, look, it's a straight line. But all those points are not lined up. Yeah, that's the reason why I got the second button, which is this one. Et voila, everything's nicely lined up. A second one. I'm personally a edge modeler, which means most of the time I start off with a flat surface, and from a flat surface I create a 3D model. Now, if I have to create something like, let's say, a wheelhouse of a car, I'll just start off with a disc so I have the round shape, and from there I'll work to square. Major problem there is the following. Maybe I started off with a straight object and then I have to go to circle. How can you accomplish this? So again, I'll make a selection here of all these points. It's just a simple setup here. I'll press this button here once, and now I got a circle. It seems that I forgot a few points here. Yeah, that's my bad. So again, just use the script, scale it down, and now I have a circle, which is pretty nice, and I can work from there. Another example, let's say you do some spline cage modeling. A spline cage modeling literally means, hey, I want to have a spline and just draw the spline for the shape I want to create. And I'm going to use the spline as a guide to create my final model. This is literally a modeling technique called spline cage modeling. So what I'll do here is the following. I'll go to this object, snap to spline, make a selection of the points here, and also make a selection of the edges. Now, let me select the snap to, and right here, press this once, et voila. Seems again that I messed up here with my selection. That's my bad. Here, right now, I got this model perfectly lined up with the polygon object, which is pretty cool. Then a last one, and then I have to move to another plugin or library, is the retopology tool. And again, maybe you have scanned or created the 3D model with the motion tracker of Cinema 4D, and the mesh is pretty dense, and you want to clean it up a bit, and you don't want to use a different program, for instance, like, what's it called again? Should be somewhere here. Oh, yeah. This is also a very nice program, and I forgot the name. It's called Instant Meshes. Anyway, let's say you want to retopologize your 3D model. You can just go here to this guy. It will ask if my mesh is symmetrical or not. No, well, it's not. So right now, I can start drawing with the regular polygon tool from Cinema. And I can make some extrusions, add some points. And if I move in a little bit closer, you can see it's actually following the surface of this model. So retopology is now a lot easier. I think that this entire bundle of layouts, extra tools, selection tools, is just about 75 euros. I'm not too sure about that. But look at the HB modeling bundle if you want to add all these new features to Cinema. If you get your way around, it is worth every single penny. Now, let's continue with something else. CV. And I did promise that I would not cover the big guys, but I have to, really. CV stands for Cineversity. Cineversity is the online training resource from the States. They have a lot of tremendous, amazing good tutorials, but they also have a massive load of amazing plugins, which can really help with your workflow. So they did a brilliant job, especially when it comes to the use of splines. And I'm a big fan of splines, and I'm also a big fan of the use of Illustrator. I'm actually a trainer in Illustrator as well as Cinema 4D, and Illustrator is just a very nifty program when it comes to distributing objects. It just works pretty nice. So what I have here, let me just go to my presentation here, is a piece of artwork right here, and it's called Dials. So You just saw this, yeah, that's my bad. You just saw my little device I showed earlier. Let me just get rid of these guys. We don't need those. Seems that I forgot to install certain font. Well, it doesn't really matter. But what I would like to do is change this piece of artwork from a 2D into a 3D object. Now, first thing I have to do is, of course, I have to outline all the strokes, otherwise it won't work. Then, if you're just using the regular version of Cinema 4D without any plugins, you can save this file as an Illustrator EPS, an 8.0 version, or a 8.0 version Illustrator file. Save it to your desktop or any other place. Go to Cinema 4D, open the file, and bring it in. That's a possibility. Now, what I can do here is a little bit easier. So I'll just select all the parts over here. Go to Cinema, go to my plugins, and let me just create a new file for this. Go to CV ArtSmart and just say paste, and we're done. So currently, if I zoom out a bit, you can see I just pasted this entire piece of artwork from Illustrator into Cinema 4D without any kind of hassle. CC 2018 files, no worries. I can place this inside an extrude, turn on hierarchical, and now it's a 3D object, which can even be printed. So that easy. But that's not the only thing that you can do with CV ArtSmart. Another thing which I really like is the fact that you can actually use CV ArtSmart in combination with Cinema 4D Illustrator files, which you link instead of just bring in. So let's say you have a client who's still not very sure about what he's going to do with his logo, but you already want to animate it, or you just want to use the colors of the logo and want to bring it in. What I did here is the following, and I do have to show you, but because it took a bit of preparation on the Illustrator side and don't want to lie to you about stuff. So I got this little character. She's actually a part of the symbols library from Illustrator. You can find her under the name Tiki, which is kind of cool because it's the same name of a very good friend of mine. And what I did here is I did clean everything up. So I split everything up in different layers. Now, what I can do is the following. I go to Cinema. And inside Cinema, I have here my CV ArtSmart object. And I'll just load in Tiki. And here we go. Everything is here. But in contrast to what I did before, now the file is linked. So this means that if I want to make some changes in Illustrator, I can do this and then just update this object. Also, I have the opportunity to change the distance between the extrudes or the layer spread. Let's set this just to one or so. And I can even bring in the materials from Illustrator straight into Cinema 4D. Now, quite recently, I did a presentation for Playgrounds Festival just about half a year ago, and they are all about 2D animation. So they think, well, 3D software can't do anything for me here. Yes, it can. The only thing you have to do is, well, use the luminance channel of your materials instead of the color channel. Choose a camera perspective which is isometric. Let me get rid of this guy. Move her up a bit, something like this. And now if I render, I got a 2D image. That easy. So you can see it even works in this kind of fashion. The good thing about this is it's not only an object, it can also be a MoGraph object. So now, let's say I got this figure over here and I want to animate her. I want to do some cool stuff with her. I want to have her dance. Just by using the MoGraph option, I can use MoGraph or effectors, or even better, if I now make this object editable, you can see what's actually beneath all this. They're just fracture objects with stuff inside. So the next phase could be, let me just grab these two arms, or maybe the torso, why not? Go to a MoGraph effector, let's say a plane effector or sound effector, which is nice. Load in a sound file, right here. And we can just straighten up and fly, which is good. And I want to use the rotation on some parts here, let's say the heading or something like that. And right now, inside the arms, I have the sound effector. And if I play the sound, we can see some movement going on here. That easy. So again, it's a very easy way of making sure that you can use Illustrator files inside Cinema 4D without a lot of hassle, without a lot of problems. Let's open this note a bit better. So we got some movement here going on. This is just one of those plugins from Cineversity. Another one I really would like you to see is something called CV Import Images. And it's not really a plugin you'll find here, but it's nested. And let me just zoom in a bit right here. And this is also something I use a lot. I have to, well, use image planes as templates for models that I would like to create. So this means you create a new material, you load in an image, you make a plane which is the same size as the image, then you place the material on the image, and then you can start doing stuff. This is about 8 or 9 steps. So what I can do here is just say, I want to have a plane from an image, please. It will ask me what image I would like to use. Let's say an Audi TT reference, and I'm done. It's already there. The only thing missing on the plugin, I hope you guys from Cineversity are listening here, is the opportunity to change the texture preview size by default as well. That would really help. But for the rest, it's an absolute time saver. And you can do sprites, you can do skies, you can just do about just about anything. And again, you can do exactly the same with Cinema 4D, but it takes a lot longer and a lot more steps to get there. Then, another one, and this is an absolute favorite of mine, Spline to Objects. I can't show you all the plugins of Cineversity. I don't have to. They have some very nice tutorials on their own plugins as well. But let me just tell you a little, well, problem I often encounter when I do my modeling. Let's say this is the racetrack of one of my clients, and I have to make it flat. So what I have to do here then is to create an object out of this, I have to have an outline. This means I have to make this object editable, go to my point mode, go to my create outline, and create an outline. Well, looks good. I can extrude this, and then I have my 3D object. The only problem is my client will come up to me and say, yeah, but can you make it a bit smaller, or can you make it a bit larger? Oh, of course. I can make a selection of these points. Just grab my scale tool and scale this up, and then you will see a little problem here. The rounding is, of course, off. It doesn't work like that. I have to do all the steps all over again. So therefore, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to do something else. I'm actually, must say, I'm pretty proud of this design. It's the Rubik's tap. So we got red for the hot water and blue for the cool water. I thought it was a good idea. Anywho, what I like to do here is turn this Rubik's cube off for now. We don't need that. And just go to the tap sweep over here. And first things first, what I would like to do is I want to round off these corners. And you can do this by using a camfer, of course. But if I make a camfer once, I'm kind of stuck to this, and I don't want to do this. So therefore, I'll do the following. I'll select the spline who creates the camfer, go to my plugins, go to the CV spline objects, and just add a camfer object. Well, right now, let's do this again. I have seen this problem before. Let me just introduce it again. CV camfer, drag it here inside, drag this guy here inside. And what I can do now is make the camfer a bit smaller. And with a little bit of luck, now you can see I have a camfer on all the edges. It will get the highlights. And I can do exactly the same with the tap nozzle here. So you can see this is completely closed. I'll go to my plugins again, go to the spline objects, and just create a CV outline. And by bringing it back, you can see I created an outline of the spline without having to make it editable or do anything else. So again, this is one of those very powerful plugins you really want to have. Also, you can animate this over time, which can result to some pretty awesome motion graphics. So these are the Cineversity plugins I wanted to show you. Now, let's go to another one. And you can see I set something after this file name here, or the folder. It says release 19. And I must say that the Selection Supplementives plugin does work in release 20. But for some reason, the translation is not French anymore, but Czech. And well, my Czechoslovakian language is a bit rusty. So therefore, let me just show you this in release 19 instead. This is, again, one of those plugins you've probably never known about because it's a French plugin and their entire website is in French. But it's from CodeFunk. And CodeFunk decided that we have a lot of problems with selecting polygons, and they're completely correct. We can do all kinds of stuff with the selection of polygons. For instance, you can grow selections, string selections. You can, well, have loop selections. But still, there are quite a few things amiss. So I got a scene over here that we actually used for a video or a virtual reality project that we did for Disney. And let's say I want to have this selection, well, stepped. So I can have a light, then nothing, a light, and then nothing. This would literally mean I have to go to my selection tool and start deselecting these polygons over here, which is a lot of work, and I'm a very lazy person. So what I would like to do instead here is go to the selection supplementives. They're over here. And just go to select points alternately. And I can just say, hey, I want to select one polygon, and please leave then a gap of two. Done. So right now, if I make an extrude or something like this, it's just by polygon. Selection supplementives, code vonk, if you want to get there. Another one, which is now a bit less important. It's kind of nonsense to do this right now because we got now the fields in release 20. But still, I want to show you is the following. I go to my plugins. And let's say I want to create some kind of random effect so I can have a more like techno sci-fi outside. Go to the selection supplementives, and here I have something called a random selection. I can have a seed and just say apply, and bam, I got a random selection of polygons, which is pretty cool. So I can give them a little different color. Maybe I can extrude them a bit so it looks really technical and stuff. And you can see it is very easy to work with. We already have some kind of science fiction city in this way. These are already pretty cool. But now, let me show you one of my absolute favorites. And this is a time saver. I don't want to do the random selection. No. What I would like to do is the grid nightmare. Yeah. I recently had this problem. I created some kind of shoji screen for a Japanese setup. And I made the stupid mistake of not saving my selection of all the small boxes here. So what I had to do is try some kind of loop selection and an inverse selection. And anyway, it would have taken me just about 10 minutes to select all those small boxes so I can give them a different color or extrude them or anything. It was a little nightmarish scenario. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to selection supplementives. And here you have something called select by polygon size. It will look at the current selected polygon. It will take the size of it, literally square meters. And if another polygon is just about the same size with a certain tolerance level, just press apply, done. This is pretty awesome. I see some smiles there. Oh, by the way, did I tell you it's free? You want this. So yeah. Another little-known plugin. Also, UV Vonk has some pretty powerful UV tools. Also, some extensions for body paint. So if you are a UV guy, go to the website UV Vonk and see what you can do. Not all their plugins are free, but I believe this one is. So see what you can do. Again, it does work in release 20, but you get some really weird language stuff. But yeah, I think they will update this soon. Now, let me go to the next one, which is called Publish4D. And to be absolutely fair, Publish4D is release 20 ready. I already talked to Kent about this. The only major problem here is Publish4D is linked to your serial number, and I was too confused or too bored or too lazy to send him my new serial. So this is all on me. It just works also in release 20. But when it comes to the features, you can see I got this menu over here. And you can see some really weird stuff that might not look pretty familiar here. A marker view, content view, material view. You have something called a VR viewer, which is in beta. And some draw objects. And yeah, at first it doesn't really make sense. But that's because it's not really about cinema. It's all about Acrobat. So if I now go to my file menu and say export, you will find PDF. And I got a little story here about this. I actually did a training in the south of the Netherlands, in Maastricht. And there were three girls who wanted to do a thesis about something with the spine of a human being. So they had some MRI scans. They had some theories about this. I'm not a doctor, so I'm not going to even try to define what the hell they were doing. They were very bright, very intelligent people. And they had this thesis, and for this thesis, they needed a 3D model, and they needed to show them to their professors. Now, little story about the computers in the schools of the Netherlands. Ouch. They're not good. I believe that the Netherlands is the only country in the world where Windows 95 is still supported. Yeah, it is that bad. So imagine that you are a student, a PhD student, and you have to give your thesis to a professor which has a computer with less power than probably your current iPhone, and he has to see a 3D model. How on earth are you going to accomplish this? And the answer is a PDF. PDF can support 3D already for quite a long time. And yeah, with Publish4D, you can just export a PDF file with a 3D model inside. The only thing that the viewer needs is a PDF reader, which is free from Adobe. And yeah, you can see here, I got the opportunity to show a model in PDF to my client. So this can be pretty handy for prototyping stuff. I must say that the lighting options of Acrobat are really cat-like. So we got some bright lights, and we got some, yeah, red lights, and oh, that's pretty Amsterdamish. Some cut optimized lights, yeah. So this is pretty bad, and I admit that. But then if you look at 4D Publish to the tools, you actually have some tools to bake, for instance, the ambient occlusion or your global illumination. So no light problems, and you can just share your files with your client. It will look at those files in PDF, and you have the most compatible, well, 3D viewer out there. So for Publish4D is not a free plugin. You have to pay for this. But with the plugin comes the opportunity to create a splash screen, to bake your textures. And I really must say, this was a hassle in the past. If you want to do something like 3D in a PDF, you have to export it in a certain format from Cinema 4D, bring it into MeshLab, export it to something else, and bring it in a lot of work. And it never looked very nice. So I'm very happy that I did this. Again, it's a Release 20 plugin, but I didn't register it yet. Then, another one, Magic Slow Motion. And this is so cool. I'm currently using this also in Release 19, and it's from a guy called Nitro4D, nitro4d.com. Go to his website. He has a ton of free plugins. They're pretty amazing. He also has videos how to use them. They're pretty cool to watch as well. He did not update them all for Release 20 yet, but I think he will do this on a short notice. And one of the things that he created is a plugin which is called Magic Slow Motion. Well, if you are using Dynamics inside Cinema 4D, this is how I ball most of the time, especially when I'm drunk, you have a certain reaction time. So let's say you want to slow down your entire system. You want to slow down the entire dynamic system to create an effect like the Matrix, you know, Neo standing in front of the bullets and everything suddenly goes in slow motion. You can do this by changing the time scale. You can animate the time scale, which literally means let's go into slow motion, and everything connected to the dynamics engine can be slowed down or speed up. So I could do this by hand, or I can just use the free Magic Slow Motion. So what this does is it will give me here a gravity parameter, which is of course 1,000 or 970 something something. I got a minimum and a maximum slowdown, and I can set where the slow motion will start and where it will end. So right now, if I play my animation, you will see that I start bowling, and here the slow motion strikes. A bit too late. So let's change this to, let's say, 15 frames. To 30 frames, something like that. And now, if I get my camera in the correct position, I may have this matrixy effect of boop, boop, and I can endure it and can do anything with it that I like. It actually helped us quite a lot, and with a little bit of trickery, we are able to connect the magic slow motion object in previous projects with X particles, so also our particles were slowing down. It's pretty cool, and it's free, so again, it can really help you out. Now, we're going to a fast list, but this is just too much fun to, well, not mention, Reaper. And lately, we have been working on quite a few projects that have to be photorealistic. I'm currently working on an animation of a ship from the golden age of the Dutch. That has a lot of rope, I can tell you. We also just finished off an animation of a Japanese room, and inside this Japanese traditional room, we had this cooking pot, or water boiling pot. And it also needed a rope. It was one of the hero objects of our scene, so just the texture did not work. So what I'm going to do here is just select the rope, go to the plugins, and here I'll find something called Reaper 2.0, and now I have a rope. That easy. So what I can do here is follow these values that I very conveniently already typed in. So let's have 1600 coils. The radius of the rope will be 1.5, and the distance will be 1.8. And right here, you can now see I start to get a rope. I can increase the amount of strands to 2 or 3. And now if I zoom in, you can see I have a very decent rope. You can choose between different kind of ropes, like embroidered or just twisted. And again, it's a free plugin, which can be very handy if you need to get some really high resolution ropes inside your scene. Also, of course, if ropes have a tendency to become, well, longer and shorter if you connect them between points, this can be very handy because it's, of course, an object which is completely parametric. If you do not have a render server or render client who can use Reaper because the plugin is not installed, you can just make it editable. And right now you can see what it created, just a few sweeps. So you also always have the possibility just to bake it if you want to use it on a network. Now, let me head to the following, which is one of my absolute favorites. Yeah, the uniform resizer. And let me just jump into my layout. This is how I usually work. Normally, I would not be allowed to show this on the presentation because it looks bonkers. But yeah, this is how I work when I'm at home and start to modeling. And you can find this little thingy over here, which is the uniform resizer. And what this does is it will give you the opportunity to resize a polygon object by value. And it sounds maybe a little bit weird, but let me just show you. I have a parametric cube over here, and I'll give it a certain size. Let's say something like this. Now, if I define here the fact that the width of this object should be a bit less wide, well, I can type it in here in the object properties, or I can use the scale over here. And if I type it over here, you will see that the entire object will uniformly scale to this certain size. Now, something that has been bothering me for quite a bit is the following. I have this car over here, and I know for sure that the DeLorean is not only 122 centimeters long. So let me just type in 420, which is, I believe, the correct size. Oh yeah, we have a little problem here. We cannot really scale it proportionally. So me thinking, being clever, I decided that with a little bit of espresso, you can actually, well, fix this by just setting some drivers and drivens. I posted it in one of my video tutorials on Vimeo, and Lester Banks picked it up. And Lester Banks, you might know, is a big website where they cover a lot of plugins, not only for Cinema 4D, but also all the other 3D software packages. And they thought it was a very good tip. And then I found out that a few guys from, I believe, Eastern Europe also saw this tutorial and said, yeah, but what you do is kind of silly. You know what? We'll just create a plugin for you. Next day, new plugin fixes this. So it's called Uniform Resizer, and I'm somewhat partly responsible here. But what you see here is just the possibility to set the current value of a polygon object. And we're done. It works. So if you are working with models which come in from a different, let's say, CAD software, You can just scale it by size. You don't have to use a scale tool and narrow it down to a certain part. So this is going to be, this is going to be interesting. The plugin is free, but it's also donationware. So please donate to this guy's uniform resizer. It's always a part of my layout just because I like it. Now, let me get into release 20 again for the last two bits. And I'm a bit scared here to present this, not because I do not trust the software or the plugin, but I do have a bit of a problem here with the network. We're at the IBC, and just to give you an impression of how many networks we have here, this is just the start. It will grow. This entire room is completely filled with a lot of radiation, and I'm probably already growing some bulbs here on my head by now with all the Wi-Fi radiation going on. And the thing is, in this demonstration, I'm going to use the Wi-Fi of Maxon, so I'm hoping they're not downloading all the seasons of Breaking Bad right now, okay? Because it will slow down what I'm going to do in the second part of this part. So, let me show. Let's start off with something easier. The simple one. This is GripTools. And GripTools is freaking awesome. GripTools is not only a plugin, it's also a program, and you can see it right here. GripTools.io, IO standing for input and output, and what it does, it allows you to use different kind of devices to control Cinema 4D. So, I got here a Korg controller, which is usually used for music. I connected it to GripTools, and GripTools is now going via my port 9000 to Cinema 4D. And inside Cinema 4D, I got this robot hand with a very big remark, which is press play so that I don't forget, which is nice. So, also, I want to go to my layout here. And what you can see here is I can make a connection with this GripTool interface. You can also see some little change here, because right now I'm controlling this robot hand with my USB import. This looks pretty cool, isn't it? It also supports iPhone. It also supports Xbox controller. It also supports lots and lots of different things. So you can just buy this plugin and use all these kinds of different controllers. Now comes the good part. That's the import part, the input part. It also has an output part. So it can actually control Arduinos and actuators, servos. So I was actually thinking of buying some servos and creating a live robot hand here. They said, don't push it too far on the show. But yeah, I had some very nice contact. It's from a couple of guys from the north of the Netherlands, AV Friesland. They did a brilliant job in connecting this. And you can see, it just works fine. And I tried it also on a Behringer device. And if you have some kind of cappuccino running, so you can animate this, it actually completely works. Now, this was not the part which I was afraid of. That's this guy over here. This is just USB, so no interference. It works completely perfect. But yeah, I really hope this is going to work in one go. Again, that's not about the program, but it is about the network here. So let me just try to get this running. I got an iPad over here. I'm logging in. And right now, I'm going to connect. Let me see if we are having some threats here. Connect again. Does it work? And otherwise, I have to try it again. Again, there's so many data currently going across everywhere here that it might take a few attempts to get this guy running. I tried it in my home situation this morning, and it just worked in one go. So let me just try one more time. And otherwise, I'll just explain what is going to happen here. So, one more time. I got my connector here. This is my current number. Let's see if I got the same. Yeah, that's correct. So there's one drive available. Here we go. Yes, we got connection. And now let's go to my room. Yeah, that sounds kind of weird. I'm sorry. Press play again. And what I can do now is if everything is doing fine, and I got the connection running here, let me see if this actually runs. To connect again. Ah, this would work. But again, I'm just using other network. Yep, let me try one more time. So, like this. And stop the animation and let me just load this one more time. Again, this is just a little risky experiment that I did. It worked yesterday. You can see it. I got some proofs on video. Let's connect again. Ah, here we go. Yeah. So, right now, sorry for the guys on the other side. I'm going to walk around and look through my camera. And you can see here, I got a 3D interface. And can just move around. The reason it goes a little bit harsh right now is just because of all the traffic on the network. So we tried it with a separate router, and it goes fluid as hell. And you can actually see that I'm able to reconnect and just go through this entire scene. And I tried it at home and just was walking through my home and also walking through my home in real time. So you can do this on an iPhone, you can do this on an iPad. It literally works with the tracking software of this iPad. So you can see it right here. I can reset the camera position and I can just say, hey, switch to AR view. And right now, with a little bit of luck, you can see some tracking points. Let me show the tracking points. Reset the camera position, switch to virtual view, and just by using the tracking of this iPad, I can walk around in different rooms. And this is, of course, ideal if you have a client and you want to say, hey, where do you want to have this camera? And he's looking at the interface of Cinema and thinks, oh my God. So you just give him the iPad and it can completely work. Again, the reason it's a bit jaggy is just because of all the traffic currently on the Wi-Fi. If you have only about 20 Wi-Fi circling around your house, it completely works pretty fine. So I'm very happy to show you this last one, and also very happy it worked. Yeah, these are just a few of the plugins I wanted to show you guys. In the very near future, I'll start a new YouTube channel, which is called PlugInfo, where I will cover a lot of new other plugins coming out, because this is only the tip of the iceberg. So yeah, this was my presentation. If you have any questions, please come up to me.